It's my great pleasure to present our today's speaker, Professor Sundaram Tangevelu, and he will speak about decay on spectral projection associated to Laplacians on certain Riemann manifolds. Well, thank you very much, and please, Professor Tangevelu, go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the invitation and also for the introduction. It's nice to see a lot of people so whom I'm not able to meet in person because of this pandemic, but it's always nice to see people over online seminars and things like that. So I hope you see my screen.
Yes, we can see it.
Yes.
Yeah, so I'm going to talk about the decay of spectral projections associated to certain Laplacians on Riemannian manifolds. Even though I have mentioned Riemannian manifolds, mainly I'll be talking about Euclidean spaces, compact symmetric spaces, and maybe non-compact Riemannian symmetric spaces, and some other cases, like some other operators. So not necessarily a very general Riemannian manifold. So we'll be starting with the well-known case of Fourier series, the simplest example we can start with. So we have the Fourier series of a periodic function f. So given by this expansion, f of x is summation f hat of k exponential ikx, and f hat k are the Fourier coefficients of the function f. So let's see. So we can put in place of this f hat of k, we can put any function of k which has rapid decay, some function of say phi of k, and phi can be compactly supported, exponentially decaying, anything. So that means the corresponding function will have Fourier coefficients that will have an arbitrary decay. So it is possible to construct smooth functions whose Fourier coefficients have any given but arbitrary decay. So that is without assuming any condition on the function f. So we can always start with some coefficients, some sequence having rapid decay, and then reconstruct a function, and then this function will be smooth if this is rapidly decreasing. But then such a function will have arbitrary decay on the Fourier transform side or Fourier coefficient side. But then if I put some conditions on the function f, then we cannot have this f at k arbitrary. I mean, we cannot expect arbitrary decay on the Fourier coefficients. So that is the main theme of this talk. So this changes drastically once we impose some restrictions on the function f. For example, so we can start with say f is known to vanish on an open interval. Suppose I consider a function f vanishing on an open interval. So what can we say about the decay of the Fourier coefficients of such a function? So for example, it cannot be any arbitrary decay, it's not allowed. For example, if I assume that the Fourier coefficient have an exponential decay like this, something like e power minus a mod k for some a positive, then we can look at this Fourier series. So in place of x, I can change that into x plus iy, a complex number. So still the series will converge because I'm assuming that the Fourier coefficients have this kind of a decay. So if I assume, say, mod y is less than this a, the series will converge uniformly over a neighborhood of the real line, that is mod imaginary part of complex number is that. The imaginary part of that is strictly less than a. The series will converge. And in that neighborhood of r, then I will have an holomorphic function. But then the function f is supposed to be vanishing on an open interval in r. A holomorphic function cannot vanish on an open interval, so it's a contradiction. So this kind of a decay is not allowed for functions f which is given to vanish, which is known to vanish on an open interval. So the natural question is, suppose I assume that a non-trivial function which vanishes on an empty open set, so what is the best possible decay allowed on the Fourier coefficients of such a function? So we know that it cannot be arbitrary. So this problem in the context of Fourier transform, so instead of Fourier series, we can also consider Fourier transform. A function vanishes on an open set, and then what can you say about the possible decay of the Fourier transform, f hat of y? So this problem was studied by several people, Ingham in 1934, Levinson in 1936, and Paley and Wiener in 1934. So they consider decay of the form f hat of y is less than or equal to some constant times exponential of minus psi of y for some function psi. So this function is like, I'm just replacing that a times mod y by an arbitrary function. And so they studied this problem, and it turns out that this condition, the integrability of this function psi of t times t power minus 2 from 1 to infinity is both necessary and sufficient for the existence of such functions. So here they were interested in finding compactly supported functions whose Fourier transform had this decay, this kind of decay. So there exists a compactly supported function whose Fourier transform decays like this if and only if this function satisfies this condition. So that is the crux of the theorems proved by in various versions. There are several versions due to these people. So here is the some history. So 1934, Ingham treated the case when the function is of this form mod y times theta of y, where the theta is an even function decreasing to zero at infinity. And in order to prove his result, he used Dengyak-Carlyman theorem on quasi-analytic functions. And then one can use Radon transform and then prove Ingham's theorem for the Fourier transform on Rn. And this was recently deduced by some of our friends, Baumick, Ray, and Sen. So here is the theorem for Rn case. So theta be a non-negative even function on R, and theta decreases to zero as t goes to infinity. I'm just restating. There exists a non-zero compactly supported continuous function on Rn having the Fourier transform satisfying this estimate. If f at psi is less than or equal to c times e power minus mod psi times theta mod psi, if and only if this theta satisfies this condition, because I'm just replacing psi of mod psi by mod psi times theta of mod psi. So that condition becomes the integrability of this theta t with respect to the measure dt by t. So that is a necessary and sufficient condition. So the original proof was different, but then there's a very efficient way of proving Ingham's theorem is to use a result that is due to Chernoff. So Chernoff considered this. So this condition here, condition on the L2 norm of minus Laplacian to the powers m applied to f raised to the power minus 1 over 2m, that sum has to be equal to infinity. This is known as the Carlyman condition. So Chernoff considers smooth functions such that all its powers, the Laplacian power m applied to f, all of them has to be in L2. So you calculate the norm and then take the power minus 1 over 2m, and this series has to be not diverging. So assume that f is such a function. So he proved that if f and all its partial derivatives vanish at a point 0, then f is identically 0. I mean, you can replace this by any point. So this is Chernoff's theorem. And once we have Chernoff's theorem, it is possible to deduce Ingham's theorem. So to bring the connection between Ingham and Chernoff's theorem, so let's look at the inversion formula for the Fourier transform. But now I'm going to write the inversion formula using the spectral projections. So I will write the inversion formula in this particular form. F of x is some constant times integral 0 to infinity. F convolved with phi lambda x, lambda power n minus 1 d lambda. Here this phi lambda are the Bessel functions of type n by 2 minus 1. So phi lambda y is j n by 2 minus 1, lambda mod y power minus n by 2 plus 1. So you write down the inversion formula, the usual inversion formula, and then you integrate over Sn minus 1 first, and then that you can write it as the convolution of f with some function. So this function is going to be the Fourier transform of the surface measure on the sphere, and that will give you this Bessel function. So you have star phi lambda, and then you integrate out in the lambda variable, then you get the inversion formula. So written in this form, I'm writing it because all these guys, f star phi lambda are eigenfunctions of the Laplacian, ordinary Laplacian, standard Laplacian on Rn, and the eigenvalues are given by minus lambda square. And then so we have this minus Laplacian applied to f is simply given by integrating these projections, f star phi lambda, multiply by lambda squared, and then integrate out against with respect to this measure, lambda power n minus 1 d lambda. So now we can appeal to Plancherel theorem. Again, Plancherel theorem applied when for the inversion formula written in this form. The L2 norm will be given by, well, just take these, look at these projections, multiply by the projection by f bar, integrate out with respect to x, and then integrate with respect to lambda for n minus 1 d lambda. That gives you L2 norm of f, because this side, one can verify that this side becomes the L2 norm of the Fourier transform. That's what I have written here. So this Plancherel formula written in this form is a consequence of this formula. F star phi lambda, if you integrate it against f bar of x dx, but is that is nothing but writing the Fourier transform in the polar coordinates as lambda omega, f hat of lambda omega, and then take the L2 norm of that with respect to the surface measure, and that is nothing but this integral. And then integrate with respect to lambda for n minus 1 d lambda, you get the Plancherel theorem. So this relation allows us to relate the decay of the Fourier coefficients or the Fourier transform and the decay of the spectral projections f star phi lambda. So here this is the connection. So if we have some decay of the Fourier transform, then I can read out some decay for the spectral projections. And conversely, if I have some decay on the spectral projections, that will give me decay on the Fourier transform side. So let's see. In order to exploit this connection, so I'm going to make use of the spherical means. Actually, this is going to be sort of the theme of this talk. So I'm going to use spherical means. I'll be considering various spherical means of the given function. And then using the spherical means, I convert the n-dimensional problem, higher dimensional problem, into a problem in one dimension. Or instead of proving some result for all functions, enough to prove for radial functions or k-by-invariant functions, depending on the context. So in order to do that, I will be using the spherical means. Again, I'm explaining this in the context of the Laplacian. So let's take the normalized surface measure on the sphere mod y equal to r in Rn, denoted by sigma r, and then take the convolution of that function f with respect to this with this measure. That is integrating f of x minus y over the sphere mod y equal to r with respect to the surface measure. So once we have this, the Fourier transform of the sigma r is explicitly known. That is again given by this the Bessel functions, which we have already seen, phi lambda of, so in this case, sigma r, then given by phi r of xi. That is a Bessel function of type n by 2 minus 1 evaluated at r times mod psi divided by r mod psi power n by 2 minus 1. So we can use the Fourier transform and the Fourier inversion to rewrite this spherical means as a Fourier multiplier. So this is in terms of the spectral projections, what we have to do is look at these projections and then multiply by this phi lambda of r and then invert it, integrate out against the lambda. Then I will get f star sigma r of x. So once we have this, so instead of considering this a function of x alone, and then treating this r as a parameter, we can also think of this as a function on Rn cross Rn, which is radial the second set of variables. So I'm going to, let's say, u of x comma y. So you have convolved with sigma mod y evaluated at x, that is given by this integral. This is phi lambda of y, that is abuse of notation. I use phi lambda of y or phi lambda of r, as long as mod y equal to r, I use the same notation. So this is a radial function in the second variable. So what is the connection? So now I can think of this as a function of x, apply the Laplacian in the x variable, Laplacian power m. And then if I do that, then I will get this lambda power 2m will come inside, because these are eigenfunctions. But that lambda power 2m I can also associate with this phi lambda of y, and then that is applying minus Laplacian in the y variable to the power m. So minus Laplacian power m u as a function of x is same thing as minus Laplacian to the power m applied to u as a function of the second variable. And both of them are equal to this one, because when I apply this minus Laplacian power m, what I get is lambda power 2m inside, because these are eigenfunctions with eigenvalue lambda square. And this is the integral. So what is the another important observation here? So here I'm thinking of this phi lambda of y, that is phi r of, I mean, this is a function of lambda times mod y, and mod y equal to r. So I can also write this phi lambda of y as phi r of lambda. And then this uxy is nothing but, you just recall this uxy. So this you can think of this as a function of lambda, and this is the Bessel function of type n by 2 minus 1. So I can think of this as the Hankel transform of order n by 2 minus 1 of this function lambda going to f star p lambda x. So uxy, fix x, uxy, I can consider this as the Hankel transform of the function lambda going to f star p lambda of x. So this, think of this as a function of lambda, take the Hankel transform, that is nothing but the spherical means. So now we can appeal to Plancherer theorem for the Hankel transform. So that will allow us to conclude that the L2 norm of minus Laplacian to the power m applied to u is a function of the second variable. If I calculate the L2 norm squared, then as I said, uxy is the Hankel transform of this function lambda going to this guy. And then so I can just square this guy and then integrate against this measure. So that measure is because it's so this is coming because lambda power minus m applied to that gives me a lambda power 2m. Then we get this one. So this allows us to several conclusions. So what are the conclusions here? So suppose now I assume that the function f vanishes on open set V. And then for any x V, then the spectral means vanishes for all small enough r, because these are the spherical means. So this is take a point and f of x minus y integrate over a sphere of mod sphere of radius r. So if f vanishes near x, so f is vanishing on an open set, x is belonging to V. So for small enough neighborhood of x, the function will be vanishing identically. So if r is small enough, anyway, that smallness can depend on x. This r is small enough, this guy is going to vanish on this mod y less than some delta depending on x. So this vanishes as a function of r near zero. So vanishing of f at some point on an open set implies this. So now let's assume this decay estimate for the spectral projections. So f star phi lambda x, and then take the supremum over x coming from V. V is the set on which the function vanishes. Suppose I assume this decay is like e power minus lambda times theta lambda. So here lambda is positive and theta is the function coming from the Ingham's theorem. So initially we can assume that this theta lambda has this extra assumption bigger than or equal to C times lambda power minus half. And then I'm just considering the non-integrability of this function, theta t times t inverse dt is infinite. Because Ingham's theorem says that the existence of compactly supported function whose Fourier transform has this kind of a decay, then a necessary and sufficient condition is the integrability. So if this function is not integrable, then if I have a function vanishing on an open set and having this decay on the Fourier transform side, I have to conclude that the function is zero. So here I'm just assuming that the spectral projections have this kind of decay, where theta satisfies this condition. And then, so we have this equation relating the L2 norm of this function, Laplacian applied to U as a function of this, and then in terms of the decay of the spectral projections, then it is possible to verify that this Kalman estimate is true for this function, this as ux dot, u of x comma r or u of x comma y as a function of y. This condition is satisfied. So now we can appeal into Chernow's theorem, and then we can conclude that this function is zero as a function of y. So this will be zero for all y. So initially we started with it's vanishing for mod y less than delta x, that depending on the point x. But then once we have Chernow's theorem, then because of the Kalman condition is satisfied, this guy has to vanish identically as a function of y. So that means this will be zero. But then now we can invert the Hankel transform, because this is the f star sigma r of x. So this is identically zero as a function of r, but we know that this is nothing but the Hankel transform of this function, this projections f star phi lambda of x. This equation equal to zero, we have assuming that x belongs to V on which the function vanishes. But now we can invert the Hankel transform to conclude that f star phi lambda x will be identical. No, f star phi lambda will be zero. No, f star phi lambda x will be zero for all lambda. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. For x belongs to V, then these projections will be zero for all lambda. But then these are eigenfunctions of an elliptic operator, so they have to be real and elliptic. So they cannot vanish on an open set unless they vanish identically. That means for every x, this is true for every lambda. So the spectral projections are zero for every x and every lambda. So invert it, then we can conclude that f is zero. So this is a way of proving Ingram's theorem under the assumption that decay estimates are assumed on the spectral projections, but but I have it assumed the spectral projections have that kind of decay for all values of x, all x, but only for x at which, or only for x coming from V, where f is assumed to be vanishing on the set. Well, these are the remarks. Yeah, we have only assumed that the decay assumption on f star phi lambda of x coming from V, V is a set on which f vanishes. And also, Chernoff's theorem is needed only for radial functions. We don't need the full strength of Chernoff's theorem for all functions. So these remarks or these observations make it possible to prove similar results in various contexts. And that's what we are going to do. So I thought I will explain these things in details for the Laplacian case, but then other cases, so. Okay, I'm going to start with, so the idea of using spherical means allows us to treat similar results for spectral projections associated to several elliptic operators. And here, one setting is the non-compact Riemannian symmetric spaces. So again, this is a Laplace-Beltrami operator on a non-compact symmetric space. So this will be, I will take it as G mod K, I will write it in this form G mod K, where G is a semi-simple Lie group and K is a maximal compact subgroup. And then I will be considering functions on X as right K invariant functions on the group. So that just for convenience of notation. So this is a Laplace-Beltrami operator on the symmetric space. I will be considering this as a right K invariant and G invariant differential operator on the full group. And then the spectral projections are given by this one, the convolution of this is the spectral decomposition. Here f star phi lambda g, this is similar to the case of the ordinary Laplacian, but these phi lambdas are going to be different. And the measure, earlier it was lambda power n minus 1, now there is another measure here, mod c lambda power minus 2 d lambda, and then integrate it out, then I will get this inversion formula. Here phi lambda, capital phi lambda, are the spherical functions on the symmetric space, and this c lambda are the celebrators Harishchandra's C function. So these functions play the role of Bessel functions in the present case. They are K by invariant, that is the corresponding to radiality of the Bessel functions. They are eigenfunctions of the operator Laplacian with eigenvalues minus lambda square plus rho square, rho is some parameter. And they are explicitly known in terms of Jacobi functions. So these things can be made use of. So for example, they are K, if the f is a k by invariant function on g, g is a semi-simple Lie group, and then every g I can write in this form. This is the so-called k-a-k decomposition, k-a-r, k prime. Let's assume that it is of rank 1, then this a-r we can identify with r positive, positive real numbers, and these are some rotation variables. So by abuse of notation, if a function is k by invariant, I will simply write f of r equal to f of g. And then the action of Laplacian on such invariant functions becomes the Jacobi operator applying to f as a function of r. This is similar to the Laplacian case. Laplacian applied to a radial function on Rn becomes the Bessel operator applied to f of r. Similarly, this is the operator. So all we need is to prove a kind of a Chernoff's theorem for these Jacobi operators. So these operators have discrete continuous spectrum. These are eigenfunctions. These are given by Jacobi functions. Eigenvalues are given by lambda square plus rho square, and rho is alpha plus beta plus 1, and alpha beta are certain parameters associated to the symmetric space. And capital phi lambda g is this Jacobi function, and this Laplacian applied to phi lambda is given by this. So that's what we mentioned earlier. And the role of Hankel transform is played by the Jacobi transform. So in place of Bessel functions, I multiply. This is for K by invariant functions. Instead of Bessel functions, I use these Jacobi functions. But here there is the measure. So instead of r power n minus 1 or r power, well, depending on the Hankel transform, if it is of order alpha, then measure will be r power 2 alpha plus 1. So here this is the measure given by 2 sin h r power 2 alpha plus 1 to cos h r power 2 beta plus 1. So this is the Jacobi transform. And the Jacobi transform has an inversion formula, and that is given by integrating the Jacobi transform against this p lambda alpha beta r. That is the same thing as the case of similar to the Bessel transform case, the Hankel transform case, but then the measure is different. There it was the same measure, lambda power n minus 1. But here the measure is different. The measure is coming from Harishchandra's C function. So anyway, these are explicitly known. So we can write down the spectral decomposition of the Laplacian in terms of phi lambda alpha beta in this form. So this is the inversion formula written in terms of the spectral projections. So this is similar to what we have written in the case of Hankel transform, the Fourier transform on Rn. So we need an analog of spherical means. So in order to define the spherical means, I just consider, remember that this G has a KAK decomposition. So I just start with any function on G and then look at this fix a point H coming from G, look at H, F evaluated at G by F of G, K, H. DK, K is the maximal compact subgroup, so it has a Haar measure. Integrate out F of G, K, H with respect to K. Then if I start with F, a function on the symmetric space, so this is right K invariant. And if the F is right K invariant, then we can verify that this becomes K by invariant. So I can define U of G comma H as a function of two variables. AHF at G, you simply call it U of G comma H. If F is right K invariant, one can verify that as a function of H, it is going to be K by invariant. So therefore, its spectral decomposition will be given in terms of the Jacobi transform. So the spectral decomposition of UGH is a function of H that will be given by the Jacobi transform. So what are the Jacobi transform for this? That is given by this F star phi lambda G. So these coefficients are the spectral projections associated to the Laplace-Beltrami operator evaluated at G. They becomes the Jacobi transform of UGH, the spherical means as a function of H, because as a function of H, it is K by invariant. So now we are in business. So if we can prove a Chernoff's theorem for the Jacobi operator, then we can prove an Ingram theorem, just like the Euclidean case. So all we need to prove such a Chernoff's theorem. But for the Hankel transform, it was already there. So I'm just here, I'm just in order to prove a Chernoff's theorem for Jacobi operator, I'm going to make use of the following result due to the issue. So here is a theorem. He proved it in the higher dimensional case, but then for our purposes, it is enough to consider the one dimensional version of the issue's theorem. So let's take a finite positive Borel measure on the real line for which all the moments m of m, that is integral t power m d mu for m bigger than or equal to 0, these are all finite. And then we assume that the moments m of 2m, they satisfy the Kalimann condition. That is summation m equal to 0 to infinity m of 2m power minus 1 over 2m, that is diverging equal to infinity. Then he proved that the polynomials are dense in LP of r d mu. So this is the theorem. This is the version we are going to make use of in proving Chernoff's theorem for Bessel operator and also for Jacobi operator, all those things. So here I will sketch a proof. So this sort of, So this is the same theorem can be proved for B alpha, these operators, L alpha beta also. So for the sake of simplicity of notation, let's write L in place of these Jacobi operators and C lambda in place of C alpha beta lambda. And F is a function on R plus satisfying this Kalimann condition. And then I'm going to define a measure mu F on the Borel subsets of R. and it is defined like this, minus infinity to plus infinity phi of t. I want to integrate a function with respect to this measure. That is same thing as looking at phi of lambda squared plus rho squared, integrate against mod f tilde lambda mod c of lambda power minus 2 d lambda. So this defines a positive finite Borel measure. I mean, you have to put some conditions on the f tilde, the decay condition, so that this will be finite measure. And then it follows that the 2mth moment of this measure, if you integrate t power 2m, this function, then this is lambda squared plus rho squared per 2m. But lambda squared plus rho squared is the eigenfunction. These are the spectral values of the Jacobi operator. So now we have this condition, but if I use the Plancherel theorem, then this right hand side becomes the Laplace-Beltrami, the Jacobi operator to the power m applied to f, and then taking the L2 norm, that is the going through the Plancherel theorem. So using Plancherel theorem, the assumption on the function f translated into the Kerlyman condition on the moments. This is this along with the given Plancherel theorem and the given condition. So Kerlyman condition is satisfied by the moments m to m. Then we can appeal to the Schuh's theorem. So the polynomials will be dense in this case, L1 of R d1. So if we assume that f vanishes near zero, then it follows from the inversion formula that this is zero. So we have an inversion formula, apply L power m, then that goes L power m applies to phi lambda of r. These are eigenfunctions, we get this one. All these things are zero. And then now we can take the limit as r goes to zero. And these spherical functions at the origin are not equal to zero. Actually, we normalize them so that the value is one. Then we conclude that for any polynomial, then we get p of lambda squared plus rho squared f tilde of lambda mod c lambda per minus 2 will be 0. And then from that, using the fact that polynomials are dense, actually here the polynomials are polynomials in lambda squared plus rho squared, some modification has to be done. But this f tilde lambda is also an even function. If you think of that as a function on the full real line, they are also even functions, so it's enough to consider even polynomials, and that so one can do something. So we can prove the Chernoff's theorem. So once we have Chernoff's theorem, then we have the Singer theorem. So this is for non-compact Riemannian symmetric spaces of rank one. So same theorem, theta be a positive decreasing function, same condition, vanishing at infinity, and then assume that integral 1 to infinity theta tt inverse dt is infinite. And if f belongs to L1 is a non-trivial function vanishing on an open set, then it is not possible to have the estimate. So the mod f star phi lambda x, this cannot have this kind of a decay, e power minus c lambda theta lambda for all x in V. If that condition is satisfied, then the function has to vanish identically. So that is the Ingham's theorem for the, I mean, this is a theorem on the restrictions on the decay of Fourier coefficients are the spectral projections on a Riemannian symmetric space under the assumption that the given function vanishes on a non-empty open set. So that is the theme of this talk. So we have a Chernoff's theorem for Bessel operators also. So that allows us to prove a Ingham's version of Ingham's theorem for spectral projections associated to Dangle Laplacians corresponding to various root systems and cosetted groups, etc. So it is similar. I mean, so here we have this B alpha, these families of operators. So the same ideas can be used for other operators having discrete spectrum. And these are continuous spectrum. But here I want to consider at least give two examples where the operator has discrete spectrum. So we'll have expansions in terms of Jacobi polynomials and then Legger polynomials. So these are the other two examples I want to talk about. So the Jacobi polynomials are coming in the context of compact Riemannian symmetric spaces. So again, they are similar to non-compact, except that here this G is semi-simple, but it is compact, and K is a suitable subgroup, so that this will be a symmetric space. Again, we assume that it's rank one. Here we have the Cartan decomposition as before. Earlier, A was identified with 0 to infinity, R plus, but now it will be identified with some interval, 0 to R, R finite. and use the Cartan decomposition to parameterize elements of A by AR, R positive. We'll, most of the time we'll be considering as a function of R, R coming from this interval. And then what is the spectral decomposition? So there is a Laplace Beltrami operator on G mod K. What is the spectral decomposition? That is given by the Peter-Weyl theorem. So we have to consider the spectral the representation theory plays a role. So any function F on the symmetric space is a right invariant function. So if you want to expand, you appeal to Peter-Weyl theorem. All we need is to consider only the so-called class one representations. And that is the set GK hat stands for the class one representations of the group G. And then this, well, so the then we have this F star phi lambda G. So phi lambda will be the characters of these representations, and they can be realized as Jacobi polynomials, and d lambda are the dimensions of the representations. So all these things, everything is encoded here. So we have a discrete, so similar to the non-compact Riemannian symmetric space, we have this expansion. Now it's discrete, earlier it was continuous. So once we have spherical means, we can do similar things. I think I have explained everything here. So this is the subset of the unitary dual consisting of class one representations. And these phi lambdas are turned out to be Jacobi polynomials now, not functions. And eigenvalues, I will just call them the C lambda. Again, I can add some fixed constant to make it squares of something. And then the normalized functions, d lambda power half phi lambda will be an orthonormal basis for L2 of functions on A. A is an interval now. Again, there is a measure, suitable weight. So there will be an orthonormal basis. And then here is the spherical means. So again, I use the KAK decomposition, take a function, F, and then look at F of G, K, AR, K prime. So this is the KAK decomposition of H, if I just call it H. Then integrate out both K and K prime. Then as a function of R, I will consider this as a K bi-invariant function on G mod K, on G. So this will be a right K invariant function of G, and then as a function of G, it is a right K invariant function. So this is a function on the symmetric space. But if I consider it as a function of the other variable, then it is K by invariant. And the Peter-Weyl expansion of the spherical means is given by this. Again, you see that spectral projections are the, if I expand in terms of R, I will be expanding in terms of these functions. These things appear as the coefficients. Jacobi polynomial coefficients of this function. Otherwise, you can just think of this, you use the Peter-Weyl theorem to expand and then take the convolution. Well, this also can be realized as convolution with certain measure. And if I take the convolution with that measure, then there is a nice property of these spherical functions, and that the convolution structure just splits this, and then you get this convolution coming. Anyway, so I won't have time to explain all those things. So now I can take the restriction of the Laplace-Beltrami Laplacian to bi-invariant function. Then that will be given by this operator, and similar to the Jacobi operator, but then it's for which the polynomials are eigen functions. So instead of Jacobi transform, we are now going to take the result in terms of the Jacobi polynomial expansions. I'm taking a function from this space, and this is expansion, and these are the coefficients. F at lambda integral. So here I haven't normalized it, so I have to put this d lambda here. Usually I said that I have to normalize it so that it will be an orthonormal basis. Here it is, I'm defining this transform without normalizing, but then I have to put this d lambda here. So assuming that f vanishes near zero, and this Laplace delta naught power EMF L2 norm satisfy the Kalman condition, we want to show that F is zero. The proof is very similar. Again, we are going to appeal to the Schuh's theorem for the measure mu F. Now this measure is defined on the Borel subsets of R by this. Mu F of set E is the summation d lambda mod f hat of lambda. So I will sum over only those lambda for which the c lambda belongs to the set. Well, this you can verify that this has all the required properties. If vanishing near zero guarantees that this is zero, and the moments, if you just calculate the moments, then you will get this expansion multiplied by c lambda power m, because c lambdas are assumed to be the eigenfunctions corresponding to delta naught. Then the same proof. Proof of Shenow's theorem for delta naught is completed. And then once we have Shenow's theorem, then we have this result. This is Ingham's theorem for the spectral projections associated to compact symmetric spaces. The conditions on theta are the same. Here I'm not talking about the converse of that. That is a different story. So integral 1 to infinity theta t inverse dt is infinite. Then a function vanishing on an open set, non-empty open set, cannot satisfy this condition unless it vanishes identically. That is the kind of result. So this kind of estimate is, this kind of a decay on the spectral projections is not possible for a non-trivial function vanishing on an open set. So we have this theorem. So this is for the Jacobi polynomial expansions. Well, here I have some remarks, but these are spherical functions. Then phi lambda star phi lambda is phi lambda, so a nice property. So once I have this, we can replace this hypothesis. The spectral projections having this decay can be replaced by the L2 norms of the spectral projections having this kind of decay. Or even we can replace the condition by, instead of assuming over V, we can also assume this kind of decay over V complement. I mean, this is something special for the compact case. So under these or under this, any of these conditions, any of these assumptions, we cannot have a non-trivial function vanishing on an open set still having this kind of decay on the spectral projections or the L2 norms of the projections. So that takes care of the Jacobi polynomial expansion and compact symmetric spaces. So now I have the final example is, I said I will talk about Legger functions or expansions in terms of Legger functions. So that takes us to the case of Hermite and special Hermite operators. So it's better to put everything in the slightly bigger, broader context of the Heisenberg group and the sub-Laplacian. So let me introduce the Heisenberg group. Hn is Cn cross R, and this is equipped with the group law. Well, this is a non-commutative group. Z, T times W, S is Z plus W, T plus S plus half imaginary part of Z W bar. And this is the sub-Laplacian. So this is nothing but sum of squares of certain vector fields. So the Heisenberg group, the Lie algebra is 2n plus 1 dimensional. So there is one vector field corresponding to the center, that is R, d by dt. So let's not include that. But then other 2n vector fields are there, left invariant ones, xj's and yj's. Just take sum of xj squared plus yj squared. That is the sub-Laplacian. It's not elliptic, but it's sub-elliptic and it has nice properties. And explicitly, this is the operator. And this operator has the Hermite operator and special Hermite operators are related to this sub-Laplacian. So what is the relation? So take a function of z and then multiply v power I lambda t. Think of this as a function on the Heisenberg group. Apply sub-Laplacian. You'll see that there is d squared by dt squared and then there is a d by dt. So d by dt acting on this will give me a lambda I lambda here, and d squared by dt squared will give me a minus lambda squared here. So and then c power I lambda t will be standing out. So there will be remaining thing will be acting on f. So I define this L lambda by this equation. Well, you can just write it down. Just put a plus here lambda squared plus I times lambda. That is the operator, L lambda. And then the Hermite operator H lambda is, well, that is related to the sub-Laplacian via a representation theory. So I'm not going to define these representations. So for each lambda not equal to zero, there is an irreducible unitary representation of the Heisenberg group realized on L2 of Rn. And then this is so that representation will extend to the as a representation on the Lie algebra, and then I can define pi lambda of L, and that will give me an operator on acting on Rn, and that is the operator Hermite operator. But I will write it explicitly. Explicitly, this is Hermite operator is minus Laplace n plus lambda squared mod x squared, and a lambda is that's what I said. So this is a lambda squared here and I lambda here coming from the first derivative. And the second two derivatives in the central variable. And the spectral decomposition of these guys are well known. All these operators, H lambda, L lambda, consist of these points. H lambda and L lambda both consist of, the spectrum of these operators consist of 2k plus n mod lambda, k belonging to n. So here lambda is fixed. And the spectral decomposition of this L lambda, which we call the twisted Laplacian or the special Hermite operator, that is given by this expansion. So the eigenvalues here, lambda is a parameter now, and here is the projection. We have star lambda, phi lambda, we said. So here I'm taking a function f, and this is the something called the lambda twisted convolution of here is the definition. Lambda twisted convolution of two functions on Cn is given by this f of z minus w g of w. DW is missing. If you just integrate, you get the convolution, but then you put this oscillatory factor depending on lambda, then you get the twisted convolution. And phi k lambda, so these phi k lambdas are going to play the role of the Bessel functions or Jacobi functions in the case of the Heisenberg group. So these are Legendre functions of type n minus 1. So there is a Legendre polynomial, Lk n minus 1 half mod lambda mod z square, and then multiply by the Gaussian e per minus 1 fourth mod lambda mod z square. So you get the Legendre functions. So here is the explicit spectral decomposition for the sub-Laplacian. So the whole thing, if you just, this gives me representation, expansion of the function f lambda. So take a function f on the Heisenberg group, in the t variable take the Fourier transform, Euclidean Fourier transform. And that gives you a function on Cn. And you expand in terms of these spectral projections and then invert it. That is the spectral projection for the sub-Laplacian. So when f is a radial function, then when I say radial, it is radial in the z variable. And for such things, this operator L becomes a simpler operator. This minus Laplacian d squared by dr squared minus 2n minus 1 by r d by dr minus r squared d squared by tt squared. And then for lambda, we can define this operator, again, similar to the sub-Laplacian case. This is the action. So this will replace the Bessel operator or a Jacobi operator in the case of these things. And for such operator, the decomposition becomes simpler. Instead of the convolution, I have these coefficients, rk lambda f, and rk lambdas f are given by, take the Fourier transform in the last variable, and then this is just a Legendre expansion. So these are Legendre functions. Just forget about lambda. These are Legendre expansions of the function f. It's a function of r. And then, so I can just normalize them. Then these are the so-called spherical functions coming from the UN action on the Heisenberg group. And they play the role of Jacobi functions and Bessel function. So we can appeal to the theorem of the issue and then prove a version of Chernoff's theorem for the operators L0 lambda. And this in turn will be can be used to prove Engram Times theorem for the Fourier transform on the Heisenberg group, and also for the spectral projections associated to H lambda and L lambda. So that is the theorems. Sorry about that. So here the spectral projections are L and L naught are via spherical means on the Heisenberg group. I think I haven't defined them well. So these are the spherical means taken averages over orbits of the unitary group. So I'm not explaining those things. I think I will not have time to explain this. So we have this theorem. I think I have this result. So mu r is the measure, normalized surface measure on mod z equal to r in Cn, but I consider this as a measure on the Heisenberg group, and this is the definition. F star mu r is given by this one, and then I think I'm running out of time, so I expand this. You have f lambda star lambda mu r that is given by this expansion. And so now if I assume that this f lambda vanishes on an open set v lambda for each lambda, and it is clear that for any z in that, this guy will be vanishing near zero. And then we have this relation, and that allows us to estimate the autonom of this f star mu r in terms of these spectral projections. And then we can prove this theorem. So theta satisfies the same condition. So here I'm taking f in L2 of Rn. So ideally I want, this is still an unsolved problem. Ideally we want to show that if f is in L2 and then f vanishes on an open set in the Heisenberg group, and then the certain spectral projections have certain decay, I want to conclude that f is zero, but here it is a very weak result. But actually this is a result only for special Hermit operator. So for each lambda, f lambda vanishes on an empty open set, and on that set, the spectral projections have this kind of decay. Then the function has to vanish identically. So that is the result we have. And again, these have nice properties because they are the spherical functions. So one can verify this condition. I mean, we can replace the spectral pointwise spectral decay in terms of L2 norms of the projections. And not only that, we can also express everything in terms of the group Fourier transform on the Heisenberg group. And yeah, this is a final result. So capital theta is an even decreasing function, and then this integral is infinite. Suppose the Fourier transform, I mean, here it is an operator, f hat lambda is an operator, and this operator star f hat lambda is a non-negative operator. I just compare with this h lambda square root of that, so that generates some semigroup. And if this can be compared with this, then if I assume that f lambda vanishes on a non-empty open set for each lambda, then f has to be zero. Ideally, I want to put the conditions on f itself, but then it's an open problem. And the spectral versions of Ingham type theorem can also prove for Hermit and special Hermit. And I think I will not state it. So the theorem will look like this. These are the Hermit projections. The theorem will look like this. And then there is one thing, there is one important remark. In proving Ingham's theorem in any setting, a crucial role is played by the existence of compactly supported functions whose Fourier transforms or spectral projections have prescribed decay. For example, in the original work of Ingham, he constructed a compactly supported F whose Fourier transform satisfies this condition where this is integrable. So this is very important, and we need to produce such examples in the case of symmetric spaces, non-compact symmetric spaces, etc. So in these compact and non-compact symmetric spaces case, one can deduce it from Euclidean thing using Abel transform and things like that. For the Heisenberg group, it is a different story. And then in another work with my student, we have constructed such a non-trivial example. So for the Hermit and special Hermit, we can produce counterexamples. I mean, examples can be constructed having these properties from the function constructed on the group. So here are some references. So I just gave only one reference, old paper of Ingham. And then this the theorem on Ingham type, Levinson type, Pelivanen types, they have got revival by these people, Baumick, Swagato Ray, Suparnasen, Sanjay Pushti, all these people. They have several papers. I just mentioned only two papers. And then we also got interested in with my student Ganguly and other students. So we have looked at these theorems of Chernoff for the Heisenberg group, and then the Ingham's theorem for compact symmetric spaces and non-compact symmetric spaces, Hermit and special Hermit operators. I think I have completed my time. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Gavilo. Okay, questions? Please raise your hand.
Yeah.
Okay, please go ahead, Professor Ruzhansky.
Yes, hello. I have a small question. So these Chernoff theorems, they are very much one-dimensional. So if you always assume symmetric spaces, you assume rank one, and also for compact and non-compact. But so how about, let's say, in two dimensions?
No, there are Chernoff theorems proved by Baumick, Pushti, and Ray. for symmetric spaces, but they have to assume that certain derivatives vanish on an open set, not at a single point. But then if we have to assume at a single point, I think they have a proof for k bi-invariant functions. So we have tried for the Heisenberg group. Heisenberg group also, we don't have the full result, but only functions. For example, for functions which are radial in the Koronian norm, we have a theorem, or some other class of functions, we have a theorem.
Because if you're on symmetric spaces of rank one, then radial condition is natural. But somehow,
yeah,
if you're on the Heisenberg group, then why assume radial symmetry? It's not maybe it's artificial.
No, but the Heisenberg group, there is a lot of problems. So
okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. More questions, please.
Excuse me, please.
Yes.
What about to extend to this result to harmonic manifold?
In A groups, we are trying. So we still don't have a Chernoff's theorem for radial functions. Maybe. No. Once we have a Chernoff's theorem, then we can prove an Ingham type theorem. But still, we don't have.
I guess that you have to use Chernoff's theorem about on Shibley-Trim-Schipper group, I guess.
Which group?
Shibley-Trim-Schipper.
Mm-hmm.
Shibley-Trim-Schipper hyper group in the place of Jacobi or Kingman-Bessel hyper group.
Yeah.
You have just only to prove Chernoff theorem for Shibley-Trim-Schipper operators, and in order to have this theorem, Ingham theorem, on manifold harmonic manifold.
Yeah, I don't know. One can try, but we are trying the simplest case of an NA group, and then still we are facing some problems. Even simplest NA group. Yeah.
And excuse me, what about to extend also for the Cherydnik and Ovdam and Cherydnik operator?
I don't know. Maybe the other authors, Baumek, Swagato, and other people may be trying. But I don't know. I'm not familiar with those things.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay. Please, more questions. May I have one small question, maybe? When you studied Heisenberg group, you have complete answers for this particular case, or still not?
Pardon me?
For the Heisenberg group, do you have the whole theory constructed for this particular case, or still there are some theorems to prove?
No, still there are. So we have considered, if you just consider functions which are radial in the Koronian norm, then we are able to prove Chernoff's theorem. Otherwise, we have to consider a function instead of how to say that. In the Z variable, there is an UN action. So there we can expand in terms of spherical harmonics. And then if each coefficient is radial in the Koronian sense.
But you can, you can identify Heisenberg group with R 2n plus 1, and then the convolution goes to twisted convolution. Does it help or not?
No.
Okay. So you cannot get from the RN analysis?
No. From RN plus 1, you don't get. Because there is the T variable and Z variable have to be treated separately. And then this UN invariant functions, the radial in the Z variable alone, that seems to be natural because there is a group acting on that. But then the Heisenberg setup, maybe the functions which are radial in the Koronian norm, they are natural, but then there is no group on the Koronian sphere. So there are problems. There is an analog of Heisenberg spherical harmonics, but they are not orthogonal. They are not known to be an orthogonal, giving an orthogonal expansion. So we cannot use that kind of a decomposition and then piece them together. That is also fails. So I don't know.
Okay, thank you. But do you have some examples of application to the study of function theory or theory of certain functions, like application of your result to some description of functions, or
I don't know.
Studying fractional powers of Laplacians using spectral decomposition, or you don't?
No, fractional powers of Laplacian. There are works for the fractional powers of Laplacian in the case of the Heisenberg group. Also, there are results. So,
no, I mean using this spectral decomposition, does it help to?
Yeah, it helps.
Construct the integral representations, etc.
Yeah, it helps. Yeah, I mean that's what we use in studying conformally invariant fractional powers for the sub Laplacian. We use this spectral decomposition quite a lot. I mean several other theorems like Pally-Wiener theorems and Hardy's theorem, all these places characterizing the image of L2 under the Hit kernel, Siegel-Wargan transform. Everywhere this spectral decomposition is used.
Okay. Okay, more questions, please. Well, if there are no questions, I would like to ask. Well, I would like to ask you guys, please turn on your cameras and turn on your microphones. And let's thank speaker for the very nice talk.